Hello everyone, welcome back. The topic for today is Ackerman Profit's classification of malocclusion from orthodontics. Now there are various classifications of malocclusion and this Ackerman's profit classification is one of them. So in this, the Ackerman and Profit, they presented this classification in 1960 and this classification, it was proposed to overcome the drawbacks of the Angles classification. Now the most commonly used classification of malocclusion, it is the Angles classification. But now this Angles classification, they have various drawback and one of the major drawback is the Angles classification is going like is considering only the relationship in the anterior posterior or the sagittal plane, but it is not considering them in the other two planes, that is the transverse and the vertical plane. So now this Ackerman's and Profit classification, they consider the malocclusion in all the three planes, that is transverse, vertical and the sagittal. So this system, it includes the Angles classification and five characteristics of malocclusion within a Venn diagram. So what is a Venn diagram? Venn diagram is nothing but like where you draw circles which are overlapping each other and which represents various characteristics. So that becomes the Venn diagram. So in this Ackerman's and Profit classification, you're going to consider various characteristics of malocclusion within that diagram. Now, what are the silent feature of this Ackerman's and Profit classification? So in this, you're going to consider the malocclusion in all the three planes, that is the transverse, vertical, and the anterior posterior like discrepancies on the malocclusion, that is your sagittal plane. The next like silent feature is the crowdings and the arch asymmetry, it can be evaluated. So if there is any crowding which is present or if the arch it is asymmetrical, so that also can be evaluated with the help of this classification. And the next silent feature is the incisor protrusion is also taken into account when you're seeing this classification. So now we have seen like earlier that there are five characteristics which are considered in this Ackerman's and Profit classification. So in this, the first step is the you're going to see the alignment. So this is exactly how your Ackerman's and Profit classification look like. So this is the first step, that is the outermost like box which is drawn over here. So that becomes your intra arch alignment and the symmetry. So the first step is you're going to see the alignment. So in this, it involves the assessment of the alignment and the symmetry of the dental arch. So in this, like you're going to see the alignment and the symmetry of the dental arch. So that becomes your first step. And it you have to write like it can be classified as ideal, crowded or space. So you have to see how the dental arch is. So whether it is like proper, whether it is like ideal or whether there is crowding which is present or whether there is spacing which is present. So that becomes the first step of the Ackerman's and Profit's classification, that you're going to see the alignment of the dental arch. So now we have seen that the first step is you're going to see the alignment. Now the next step becomes where you're seeing the profile of the patient. So the second step is you're going to see the profile. So this is the bigger circle. So first step was this outermost like the square. Now the next step is this bigger circle, that is you're going to see the profile. So it involves the consideration of the profile of the patient. So the profile, it is described as convex, straight or concave. Now when the patient is having class 1, so that becomes a straight profile over here. Now when the patient is having class 2, so that time the patient will have a convex type of profile, and when the patient is having class 3, so that becomes a concave type of profile. So these are the various profiles that you're going to see and you're going to write whether which type of profile the patient is having. And now in this step 2, you're also going to see the facial divergence. So you're going to see whether the facial divergence, so there is anterior divergent or there is posterior divergent. So this becomes the step 2 in which you're going to see the profile. So first step was you're seeing the alignment, in which you're seeing the if the patient is having crowding or if the patient is having like spacing or if it is ideal. And the next step is you're going to see the profile, in which the profile can be convex, straight or concave. Now the third step is now you're going to consider about the various planes. So now in this we have seen that we are going to consider all the three planes, so that is the transverse. So step 3 is when you're going to see the malocclusion or the dental arch in the transverse plane, so that becomes the type. So in this, the transverse skeletal and the dental relationship, it is evaluated. Now in this, what you're going to see is in the transverse planes, you're going to see whether the patient is having crossbite or not. So in this, you're going to see whether the patient is having buccal crossbite or palatal crossbite, if there is any. So now in this, you're also going to see if the crossbite, it is present unilaterally or bilaterally. And also you're going to like evaluate or you're going to differentiate whether that crossbite is because of the skeletal problem or whether it is a dental problem. So that becomes the step 3, in which you're going to see the malocclusion in the transverse plane. Now this is the smaller circle. So that becomes your step 3, in which you're going to see about the transverse deviation. And the main thing that you're going to see in this transverse deviation is the crossbite. Now the step 4 is where you're going to see the class. So class becomes your angles classification. So angles class 1, 2 or 3. So this step 4 is when you're going to consider the dental arch in the sagittal or the anterior-posterior relationship. So it involves the assessment of the sagittal relationship. So in this you're going to write whether the patient is having angles classification 1, 2 or 3. So because of that it is a class. So that becomes your step 4. So it also helps to differentiate between whether the malocclusion it is a skeletal problem or whether it is a dental problem. So this becomes your step 4, that is the smaller circle adjacent to your transverse deviation, that is your sagittal deviation, in which you're going to see whether the patient is having class 1, class 2, division 1 or division 2 or class 3. And if the patient is having any of this malocclusion, so whether it is a skeletal or a dental malocclusion, so that becomes your step 4. And the step 5 and the last step is where you're going to see about the bite depth. So now in this, now we have seen, like, we have considered the malocclusion in the transverse plane and also in the anterior posterior plane. So the next plane we are going to consider the malocclusion is in the vertical plane. So in this, the malocclusion in the vertical planes, they are noted. And over here, you're going to see whether the patient is having open bite, whether that open bite it is present anteriorly or posteriorly, or whether the patient is having anterior deep bite, or whether they are having posterior collapsed bite. So that becomes, like, you're going to see about the depth of your bite. So whether the patient is having open bite or deep bite. And also you're going to differentiate whether that deep bite or open bite, it is a problem of skeletal or it is a problem of dental. So that becomes your fifth step over here. This is the vertical deviation, in which you're going to see whether there is open bite anteriorly, or if there is open bite posteriorly, or there is any deep bite which is present, or if there is collapsed bite which is present posteriorly, and whether that malocclusion it is present skeletally or dentally. So that becomes your step 5. So over here, now you can see this is the open bite which is present anteriorly. Now over here, this is a deep bite. So this becomes, like, where you're going to see about the bite depth. So those were the various, like, classes of your Akermans and Proffitt classification. Now how is the method of scoring? So first you're going to write all the 5 characteristics, and then you're going to score them accordingly. So first is the alignment. So now you're going to accordingly score them, whether it is 0, 1, 2, 3 or 4 or 5. So 0 will be when the alignment it is ideal. 1 will be if there is any slight, like, problem which is present, whether there is slight crowding or spacing. Or if 2 is when there is slight to moderate type of problem which is present. 3 is moderate. 4 is moderate to severe, and 5 is severe. So accordingly you're going to give the, like, score for that particular characteristic. So first is you're going to write about the alignment, and then you're going to write however the score is for that particular alignment. Then the next is the profile. So in that you're going to write whether whatever the profile is and how severe it is. Then you're going to consider about the transverse plane, the sagittal plane and the vertical plane. So transverse is when we have seen, like, we are considering about the cross bite. Anterior posterior is when we are going to consider about the angles classification, and vertical is where we are considering about the open bite and the deep bite. So accordingly you're going to score, like, how severe that proper, like, that malocclusion is present. So that becomes the method of scoring. Now, what are the merits and demerits of this Akermans and Proffitt classifications? The merits are, it is explaining all the complexity of the malocclusion, like, as we are considering everything, like, we are considering all the three planes. So because of that, it is explaining, like, the complex things of malocclusion. Then all three-dimensional problems, they are included, as you're going to consider the, like, classification in all the three planes. In this, now the patient's profile is also included. Then it is also differentiating whether it is a skeletal or a dental problem. Now in this, the arch length problems, it is also evaluated, and it helps in complete diagnosis and the treatment planning depending on that scoring, like the method of scoring which we have seen for this Akermans of the Proffitt classification. So these are the various merits of this classification. Now what are the demerits? So in this, the etiological consideration, they are not given. So what is the exact cause of the malocclusion? You're not going to consider them in this particular classification, and it is based on the static occlusion only. So this becomes the demerits of the Akermans and the Proffitt classification. So that was all about the Akermans and the Proffitt classification of malocclusion. I hope you found this video helpful, and if you did, then please like, comment, share and do subscribe to my channel. Thank you so much.